If you let a not insignificant number of U.S. fans make decisions after last month's international break, we'd probably have a new coach at the helm of the U.S. men's national team. As it is, Gregg Berhalter is still in control of the Stars and Stripes, but as much as we lament the international break as fans of club soccer, their commonality allows us as international fans to get frequent looks at the teams that represent our flag. And with Berhalter's job in as precarious a situation as it's been since he was hired, we certainly need the U.S.'s best look this break. So what should we be seeing in November's international break? Let's discuss. I think the term must-win game is thrown around a little too liberally, and I don't mean in an inaccurate way. I mean, it's thrown around so much that you start to think, okay, well, every game is must-win, and in a sense, pretty much every game is must-win. Coming into this particular international break after what happened last month when the U.S. lost 2-0 to Canada, and that, you know, it wasn't even a fluke. It was a complete domination on the part of the Canadians, an embarrassment for the U.S. men's national team, to put it lightly, I think. After all that, I was coming into this break saying, these are two absolutely must-win games. But when you look at the actual call-ups, it's actually not as black and white as we would think. See, the thing is that the U.S. now, even more than in the past, is absolutely hammered by injuries at the moment. We've known that Tyler Adams has missed the better part of the past year because of injury, and he's certainly a crucial part of the setup. Tim Weah, who's been turning in fantastic performances for club and country, he's hurt now as well, and they've both gone under the knife recently. You have Jozy Altidore, who's been battling injury as well, and now you have guys like Paxton Pomykal, who is a new guy who's really coming up onto the scene, and he has just gone for surgery on core muscle, I believe. And now you have Mr. America himself, Christian Pulisic, who is out of this month's call-ups due to injury. So all of that leads me to believe that if we're looking for the best of the U.S. men's national team in this break, we're not going to get it, because we're talking about at least four starters, because I also didn't mention Zach Steffen, who's hurt now, and he's the clear number one choice for goalkeeper. We're talking about four starters at least who are hurt currently, and a couple more guys that would come off the bench. We're not going to get the U.S.'s best team this time around. We can't, due to all the injuries. So I want to look at this a little bit differently. I'm not necessarily looking for the best results. I'm not saying that it's a failure if the U.S. goes out and beats Canada, you know, 4-0 to avenge that first loss, because it just may be the case that the U.S. doesn't have the talent to throw out onto the field right now to actually do that. What I am looking for, though, is a new mentality, and it starts, as most things do in sports, at the top with Gregg Berhalter. Here's the thing about Berhalter. I appreciate the fact that he is trying to work in new players. He's trying to experiment and see what he likes. I appreciate that. You know, I think as a coach, especially if you are a coach that's trying to take a long-term view, and clearly U.S. soccer is trying to encourage him to do that, then good. Try to figure out what you have. The problem, though, is that there are certain games where it doesn't matter who you throw out there, it doesn't matter how experimental you're being, You have to win. I mean, I don't know any other way to put it. So against Cuba, when the U.S. won 7-0, that is pretty much what was expected. Even though Berhalter was kind of playing around with the lineup and guys were doing different things, McKennie was attacking more than it seemed like he was in the past few matches. I mean, anything like that. But against Canada, not only was Berhalter seemingly experimenting with some different tactics, the mentality that should be showing through no matter who's on the field just wasn't there. In this editorial from MLS.com, I think he pretty much hits it right on the head, where he's saying Canada out-toughed, out-swaggered, out-coached, and out-CONCACAF'd the U.S. in October. It was a pure beating, a one-sided lesson in aggression, game planning, and will. I agree with that because the U.S. just is different in the world of soccer. We just come from a different background. All of the U.S.'s players come from different upbringings than guys in other countries that are dominated by the sport of soccer. And so when the U.S. has been great, it's because the U.S. has looked different than any other team. The U.S. trains differently. The U.S. thinks differently. So what the U.S. needs to be doing is embracing that. The U.S. has some of the greatest athletes in all positions because that's how we train. You're talking about guys that, you know, could have played football or basketball, and then they switched to soccer, and very often they played multiple sports before they made that switch permanently. So they just are coming at it with a different level of athleticism than a lot of guys in other countries. And on top of that, the U.S., they need to play with a bit of swagger. Not the kind of I've been there before swagger, you know, because the U.S. hasn't been there before. They'll get laughed off the pitch. But the kind of swagger that's like, it doesn't matter that we haven't been there before because we know we can get there. And when you look at the U.S.'s team sheet, when you look at their best 11, regardless of injuries, we're not going to see it, like I said, in this particular break. But if they were to put out their best 11, I see potential there because you're not talking about, you know, the best guys in the MLS. You know, you're talking about guys like Christian Pulisic, who may very well win Player of the Month in the Premier League. I mean, he'll be one of the best players in the world's best league this year. You're talking about a captain of Schalke and Weston McKennie. I mean, you're talking about real dudes that are playing in real leagues and they're having real success. So yeah, the U.S. should be bringing that level of swagger, and we just kind of saw them, you know, sit down against Canada, and that it's unacceptable no matter who is on the field. A lot of people absolutely called for Berhalter's firing after that, and a lot of people are unimpressed, to say the least, when it comes to this month's round of call-ups. Again, injuries certainly affect that. What should our expectations be, given the injuries? And, you know, I think, again, against Canada, I'm expecting a better performance than what we saw last week or last month, and certainly the U.S. now playing on their home soil has no excuse but to come out all guns blazing against Canada. Of the call-ups that they made, the best 11 should be in there, and Berhalter should be walking out there making a statement. Against Cuba, the U.S. absolutely should dominate. Doesn't matter who's out there. The U.S. U-23s, maybe the U.S. U-19s could beat Cuba. If the U.S. lose to Cuba, that's it for Berhalter. I've been patient. I want Berhalter to succeed. As a United States fan, you know, I'm tired of the manager turnaround. I'm tired of the coaching search and how that worked the first time. If they lose to Cuba, that's it, because then you start, in your mind, we start to go back to that dark place in 2017 when the U.S. could not pull out a win against Trinidad and Tobago to make the World Cup, a World Cup that was one of the greatest tournaments in the history of international soccer. If Berhalter shows that the U.S. even has a possibility of losing to an inferior team like that, it's too much. It's too much. You have to get rid of him immediately for no other reason than you just don't want U.S. fans to associate that again. Barring that, if it's a strong result against Canada, meaning that the U.S. looks like the U.S. should, they're playing with swagger, they're playing with toughness, the way that we've come to expect, and they go out and beat Cuba, that's enough results-wise. That's all I need to see from Berhalter. In terms of the kind of team that he throws out there, the starting 11 that gets thrown onto the pitch, the tactics that they play, I'm going to do a separate video in the next week or two breaking down what I think the best tactical approach is. If we're being honest with ourselves, Christian Pulisic is such a central piece of what the U.S. is trying to do tactically that without him, we're not really going to see, I think, the same type of game plan, the same level of tactics. I think Berhalter, to some degree, is still experimenting, and you can say, well, it's too late for that. He shouldn't be experimenting this long. There's arguments for that. All I'm going to say is that there are certain guys that are going to be very, very important when it comes to the long-term success of the U.S. So guys like John Brooks, Serginho Dest, who we should all be really excited about, Weston McKennie, Tyler Boyd, and Josh Sargent. These are the guys that can still play their game, can still be stuck into the tactics that they need to play, regardless of whether Pulisic is in there or not. So I want to see good performances from those guys in the positions, in the type of system that they need to be playing. What I need to see is improvement, but not necessarily improvement talent-wise, improvement on the field, so to speak, when it comes to results, more so improvement in the mentality and just in the way that the U.S. is going to carry themselves when it comes to playing these teams that they should be picking up good results against. And as a bonus, if we can see Dest show out in his first matches as an official citizen and member of the United States men's national team, then that's great. If we can see Tyler Boyd capitalize on some of his fantastic performances that we've seen in the last month from him, then that's what we need to see. If we can see Weston McKennie step up now that Pulisic is gone, and McKennie is the number one guy when it comes to guys that have had success in Europe and guys that all of the other players are going to be turning to, if we can see that, even at McKennie's young age, and if we can see Josh Sargent really start to put a stranglehold on that starting number nine role. I like Giassi Zardes, but Sargent long term is absolutely the option. If he can start to put a stranglehold on that role, then that, to me, I'm going to call it good. I am not going to start calling for Berhalter's firing due to results until we get into next year's Gold Cup, where hopefully we'll be looking at a much more healthy 11, a starting 11, a roster that is much more similar to what we'd be seeing in 2022 should the U.S. make the World Cup that year. As for now, I just want to see an awareness from Berhalter specifically that what happened last month was unacceptable, and to put all the fans at ease, to put his own team and probably himself at ease, the U.S. needed to come out and play the best match that they've played since probably the Gold Cup semifinals last summer and show everybody that the U.S. men's national team is actually on the right track, because it's not going to get any easier if Berhalter comes out and doesn't show that killer mentality that we really need to see from the U.S. Any other sport on the international level, the U.S. are killers on the international stage. They just have that mentality. And, you know, sometimes they lose. But that's okay, especially for the U.S. men's national soccer team, as long as they show that mentality, that these guys are proud to put on the uniform and they're going to go out there and represent the country. If that's what we see, then I think a lot of fans are going to be happy until the next swath of competitive matches, which is going to be next summer for the Gold Cup. So temper your expectations for the actual results on the field because of the level of injuries that we're seeing. All that we need to see is that level of mentality that we've come to expect from the United States anytime that the United States competes internationally in any sport. Let's bring that to soccer. And let's see two strong results and a lot of swagger and a lot of toughness on the field from the U.S. men's national team this time around. Thanks for watching this video. Subscribe for this and all of our content on General Admission Sports. We'll see you next time.